Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Tom Jensen. I'm the counselor for Press and Cultural Affairs at the U.S. Embassy and your host for tonight. The American Cultural Center comes under the U.S. Embassy banner, and we're pleased to have this great venue here and honored that you've accepted our invitation to come here for a discussion about the U.S. elections 2016 with U.S. Ambassador to Israel, Ambassador Daniel Shapiro. We're also happy to welcome you to our newly refurbished program room auditorium here at the center, and hope that you will find your way back here frequently. We hope you'll see this as an information resource center for you, but also a place where you can enjoy programming. And I heard Felicity talking a little bit before about the program calendar that we have here at the American Center. And you can follow the activities by following the American Center's Facebook account, where we post all upcoming events. That's just go to Facebook and go into a search for American Center Jerusalem, and that should pop up with the center and all the activities that we have going on here. But we also see this as a forum for dialogue, and we're looking for ways to engage audiences here, particularly youth audiences, and so we're glad that you've come out to hear this discussion today. Today's program is actually being live streamed on the Embassy YouTube site and Facebook site. And if you want to get to that, I encourage you to go here to Israel. Move off to the side a little bit. Seems to be a 30-second delay. Anyway, U.S. Embassy, israel.usembassy.gov/election2016.html. Go ahead and get on your personal devices there and text your friends and tell them to tune into this live streaming, or just text your mom and say, "I really am at the American Center. I'm not at the coffee shop or the bar today." One last note, though, as you're texting your friends and telling them about this great event this evening, please also put your ringers on mute so we don't have any interruptions during the program. Ambassador Shapiro will give a brief presentation, and then there'll be plenty of time for questions and answers. So without any further ado, Ambassador Shapiro.
Thank you. Sorry, I don't need that. Which one is the... Okay, we'll get to that. Welcome, everybody. It is my real pleasure to come to Jerusalem. My apologies for being a little late in the traffic. To spend some time at the American Center in Jerusalem with you to talk about the upcoming American election. If you're here, I'm guessing you share a little bit of the passion I feel for politics. I know Israelis have know something about a passion for politics. Who's here excited about the American election this year? Okay, that would bring you out. Sometimes I think people are more excited about somebody else's election than their own, and sometimes I even can sympathize with that feeling. But there's no question that there's nothing as really as important in our lives as citizens of democracies, and frequently as exciting, and frequently as fun as participating in the democratic process, the actual, the literal voting process in which every citizen, no matter who they are, no matter where they live within that country, or even outside the country maybe, has the same right to express their voice and have their vote counted toward choosing their leaders. It's sometimes we take it for granted, and we shouldn't. There are people all over the world who don't have that right, who don't have that ability, who don't have that voice in how they're governed. Again, while politics can be messy and we're not always happy with the results and we're not always happy with the choices our leaders make depending on outcomes, we are really blessed, and we should always feel that that blessing of the of those rights and freedoms, but also that responsibility to be citizens who participate, who follow the issues, who support candidates who we believe represent our views, maybe jump in and run ourselves, or in other ways participate in the electoral process, and then obviously to show up on election day and vote. When people sort of say, "Well, what's all the excitement about?" There's a lot to be excited about. I think the United States election probably is a worldwide event in many ways. And I've heard it said by people here in Israel, but by people in many other countries I've visited, that people feel a stake and that they have something riding on the outcome of an American election. It's said that David Ben-Gurion, in his meeting, I think his one meeting with President John F. Kennedy, shortly after President Kennedy was elected, in fact, I think it was between President Kennedy's election and his actual inauguration, said to President Kennedy, then President-elect Kennedy, who asked, is there anything I can do for you, anything I can do for Israel? And Prime Minister Ben-Gurion said to him, just be a great president of the United States. That's the best thing you can do. Make your country strong, make your country succeed, and the rest of the world will benefit from that. And I guess because of the United States' global role and responsibilities, we do have what happens in our elections does affect people even outside our borders. And so I guess we have to take that into account, although in the end it's we as Americans who have to make the decision. Any American voters, any American citizens in the room, by the way? Just a couple? Okay. So you may take a special focus on this. Now, a couple of ground rules. I'm not going to make, in my current role as ambassador, I'm in a completely nonpartisan function. I have participated in elections before. I've backed candidates, including President Obama when he was running in 2008. I've worked for members of Congress. But as ambassador, I function with no partisan role at all. And so I'm not going to make any predictions about the outcome of any voting in the 2016 election. I'm not going to offer any opinions on any candidates in the current election. So if the opinions will have to come from you, but I will be willing to engage a little bit on some of the history, including my own personal history, if it helps to illustrate some of the things we're talking about. So mostly I want to really talk about the process, the technical aspects of the process, because I think for those who maybe this audience is better familiar, more familiar with it than some, but perhaps not everybody, and maybe some who are watching on the live streaming, are trying to figure out what the heck are we going through right now. It's on the news every single night. There's a debate every week. There's more candidates than we can keep track of. They're all over this large country in many different states. Why are they in these states and not in those states? And how will that unfold over the next 11 months until Election Day? So let me just briefly run through some of the facts. Obviously, we are basically a two-party system, a Republican Party and a Democratic Party. Those are the primary organizing principles of our elections. There are smaller parties who sometimes field candidates for president and occasionally in congressional races, but they are very, very small. And it's been a long time since a third-party candidate has really won a significant percentage of the vote. Although even small third-party or independent candidates can have some influence in the outcome, and I will mention that a little bit later. But obviously, the two main parties are now conducting their primaries to choose their nominee, the one candidate who will represent them in the general election next November. So in the Democratic Party, we see there are three candidates currently running. Hillary's former Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton, former Governor of Maryland, Martin O'Malley, and a Senator from Vermont, Bernie Sanders. And they had a debate the other night, and it's the three of them. And, you know, I think there's a fair amount there's a lot in common to their approach to politics and their approach to issues, and we didn't see a lot of significant arguing between them. A lot of agreement, frankly, on substance, although they are trying to draw some distinctions on certain issues. The Republican primary, obviously, is much, much wider open and has many more participants in it at the moment. Three candidates have already dropped out, actually. Rick Perry, the former governor of Texas, Bobby Jindal, governor of Louisiana, and Scott Walker, governor of Wisconsin. But the other candidates are in, and polling shows different results, but it seems like most of these candidates are going to stay in at least until the early voting begins in the early primary states. So former governor of Florida, Jeb Bush, Ben Carson, who's never held political office. He's a retired surgeon. Chris Christie, the governor of New Jersey. Ted Cruz, senator from Texas. Carly Fiorina has also never held elective office. She was the CEO of Hewlett-Packard. Jim Gilmore, the former governor of Virginia. Lindsey Graham, senator of South Carolina. Mike Huckabee, former governor of Arkansas. John Kasich, the governor of Ohio. George Pataki, the governor of New York. Rand Paul, senator from Kentucky. Marco Rubio, senator from Florida. Rick Santorum, former senator from Pennsylvania. And Donald Trump, who has also never held elective office. He's a successful businessman and real estate developer. I guess celebrity reality TV star. Now, you hear most of the titles these people have held. Most of them have been senior office holders in states or representing states in the Congress, governors, senators, members of Congress. That's the typical pattern, and if you look back through our history, most of our presidents have come, far more of them have been governors, maybe earlier in their careers have been members of Congress or senators. It's fairly rare that a president has emerged directly out of the congressional experience. In fact, President Obama is the first one, I think, since President Kennedy in 1960, who won as a sitting United States Senator and went on to become president. There's something complicated about going from the Congress directly into the White House that has made that a difficult transition for a lot of candidates in the past. But obviously, every year is different. You know, as you look at the profiles of those candidates, there's some things familiar and some things newer. Among these candidates, certainly the majority are white, the majority are male. There are two women running, Hillary Clinton and Carly Fiorina. There are two Latino candidates, Marco Rubio and Ted Cruz, an African-American candidate, Ben Carson. But of course, and a Jewish candidate, Bernie Sanders. But of course, you know, in our history, we are currently in the administration of the first ever candidate who was not white and male. Barack Obama, when he was elected in 2008, was a significant change and sort of breakthrough in terms of people of different backgrounds ascending into the Oval Office. And so it's I think reflecting something about the changing demography of our country, that increasingly we are becoming soon what we sometimes call a majority minority a country, in which populations who are not the have not traditionally been the majority, the white, let's say the white Christian community, are being are seeing their percentages decline, while other populations, African American, especially Hispanic or Latino American, some Asian American, some other minorities, and different religious backgrounds, including the Muslim community, are beginning to grow in percentage terms. It's slow, it's gradual, as all demographic processes tend to be, but it does mean that the makeup of the electorate is changing with each election, and candidates in their profiles, in their backgrounds, and in how they appeal to those populations are having to adjust, and it is affecting where the election is competitive as well in different states. So how does the process work? The process is each party has to choose their nominee, and they go state by state in primaries and caucuses in order to be elected. Now, there are two different processes. There's the primary, which I think everybody is fairly well familiar with, where you simply go and it's an essential election, and you cast your vote in a secret voting booth, and they're tallied up, and the winner gets the number of delegates assigned to that state. I'll mention that again in a second. Then there's a different process, including in Iowa, the very first state to vote, called caucuses. And that's a very different process. That is a much more public process. You kind of have to go, particularly in Iowa, but it's true in some other states that hold caucuses, which tend to be smaller states, more rural states. You have to actually go to a public event. You actually have to stand up in front of your neighbors and friends and colleagues and declare your support for a particular candidate. Some states, and Iowa's one of these, might have second or third rounds where people can try to convince people over the course of an evening of a couple hours to switch their support from one candidate to another. So it's a very different kind of process, and you really have to be very committed to a candidate to want, sometimes on a very cold winter night, to go out, maybe through the snow, spend time, and declare yourself publicly before people who you're going to support. So that's how Iowa votes. New Hampshire is a more of a straight primary voting, and then the next two states after that are South Carolina and Nevada. Put the map up here. Do I have a pointer, or I don't have a pointer? Nope, I'll just use my finger. Anyway, this is a little hard, but there we go. So New Hampshire is a little state right here. Iowa is out here in the Midwest. South Carolina down here in the southern area, and Nevada way out here west where Las Vegas is. And one of the by selecting those four states as the first four to vote, each on their own day, The parties have tried to create a certain kind of geographical diversity, and in some cases demographic diversity as well. Particularly in the Democratic primary, there are a large number of voters in South Carolina who are African American, a large number of voters in Nevada who are Latino, Hispanic American. And that is to address a criticism that has evolved over the years that Iowa and New Hampshire have very small minority populations. They're generally states with larger white percentages of white voters. They're very rural. They don't have large cities in them. And so to try to gain a different, to give a voice to a voter of a different background and a different profile, the states have emerged in that sequence. The goal is to become the nominee, and that is to win 50% or 50% plus one of the delegates assigned to each state. So I don't have the exact numbers, but each state has a certain number of delegates assigned to it, maybe a few hundred from New Hampshire, probably a few dozen from New Hampshire, maybe a couple of hundred from South Carolina. As the state gets larger in population, it has more delegates assigned to it. They count them very differently. On the Republican side, you need 1,236 delegates to be elected, again, the proportion across to become the nominee across the states. And in the Democratic side, they count them differently. It's almost twice that many, 2,383. But you go through state by state, first in those four on an individual basis, and then following that, they come much more in clumps. There will be a date in early March, which is often known as Super Tuesday. Tuesday is the traditional voting day, not always, but usually it's the voting day in the United States. About 12 or 13 states, mostly across the South, and a few other states will hold their primaries on one day, and there will be a large number of delegates all assigned on that one day. Frequently, that is the day when somebody crosses the territory into having won the number of delegates, or they gain such a lead that it will be very hard for them to be passed later on. Now, each state has different rules. It's very complex, it's very technical, and how the delegates are assigned varies from state to state. So in some states, if you win by one vote, you get all the delegates. It's winner take all. In other states, it's proportional. So you can win by 10%, but you only get a small margin of delegates over your opponent. And mastering the details and the technical aspects of that is an important part of this process. President Obama, in the 2008 primaries against Hillary Clinton, really benefited from that. His campaign was very, very strategic in where they invested time and resources, including in small and rural states that held caucuses, that public declaration type of process. Let's say in Idaho, small state, actually very few Democratic voters in Ohio, in Idaho. But because of the way they do their caucuses. It was winner take all, and he did very well there because they had put in a lot of time and effort and organizing, and they got 40 or 50 delegates added to their column. California, the largest state, which has the most number of delegates, Hillary Clinton actually won that primary. But that primary is not winner take all. That primary was proportional distribution of the delegates. So she won by 5 or 10%, but she gained less of a lead than he did in Ohio, that tiny state with only 40 or so delegates. So mastering all those details, I don't think the Clinton campaign is focusing on that this year, but mastering all those details is very very critical. Now, one of the things we've seen in the past is that some years the early winners gain momentum right out of the chute. They win Iowa, they win New Hampshire, and then everybody else kind of falls away, and the party tends to rally around that that nominee. And that certainly happened to George W. Bush in 2000. It didn't happen in 2000. I'll mention that in a second. Some years that's what happened. But frequently we see somebody who wins in Iowa or in New Hampshire. It does not go on. So, you know, you'll see starting in about a month when the Iowa caucuses are held, I think it's February 1st, and the New Hampshire voting is February 9th, you'll see a winner emerge. Perhaps that person will go on to the nominee, but don't necessarily believe it. It's not over just because someone wins the first round or two rounds. It's a long enough process with enough diversity in the country and enough time that needs to be spent in different parts of the country, there won't be early. So, for example, last time in 2012, the winner of the Iowa caucuses on the Republican side, anybody remember who it was? No, that's from 2008. He didn't win at Iowa either then. Rick Santorum. He's running again. He's fairly low in the polls on the Republican side, but he won in Iowa. Then Mitt Romney won in New Hampshire, and that started Romney on his path. In 2008, it was Mike Huckabee, also running again this year, also fairly low in the polls. He didn't win. That's when John McCain emerged in New Hampshire. And other years, Clinton-Obama primary was a very dramatic one. President Obama was trailing in the primary polls through most of 2007. And then right around the beginning of 2008, as Iowa was getting ready to vote, he started to rise. And he won the Iowa caucuses, kind of as a surprise. And people were very amazed and said, wow, he broke through. This is it. He's going to march on his way to victory. And I was working for him at the time. I was working in Washington doing more foreign policy-focused work. But I did what many campaign volunteers and employees do. I got in my car. At my own expense, I drove to New Hampshire, and I spent 5 days walking through the snow, knocking on doors, handing people leaflets, telling them that I thought Barack Obama would be a great candidate. And sure enough, he lost the New Hampshire primary, and I thought, well, there goes that great idea, that great experiment. But what it meant was a very long, and remember, everybody probably remembers, a very long, very extended primary contest between him and Hillary Clinton went all the way to the end, which is very unusual. Usually by March or April, it's pretty well settled on one side or the other. Frankly, people can see the polls right now, and I think everybody knows who's sort of leading in which polls, but you have to be careful which polls you're looking at. If you look at a poll that says so-and-so is leading nationally among Republican voters or among Democratic voters, that's interesting. It's not that relevant necessarily to the primary process. The really interesting and relevant polls for the beginning process is Iowa and New Hampshire. And then maybe South Carolina and Nevada. And somebody might be doing much better in a national poll because their name is better recognized, maybe because they are getting exposure. But if they haven't spent time on the ground in those very small states who are used to having candidates come knock on their doors, show up in their restaurants and diners, show up in their schools, really meet them personally. That's the advantage of a small state being the first one, that people get a kind of a personal interaction with the candidates. They might be polling much lower in those early states. And so we've had people leading by, you know, with a lot of attention. I remember in 2004, actually the year John Kerry became the nominee for the Democrats, as late as this time in that election cycle, December of 2003, Howard Dean, who was the former governor of Vermont, was running away with the Democratic primary. He had become very popular. He had attracted a lot of young supporters. He had kind of mastered the early internet campaigning and had gone out to a big lead. And then within a month, his lead came down. Kerry shot up at just the right time, and he won Iowa and went on to win the nomination. Even 4 years ago, the former Speaker of the House, Newt Gingrich, was leading in some national polls at this time, in 2011. I don't think won a single primary, if I'm not mistaken. Very quickly, his campaign kind of didn't catch on, and Mitt Romney won the election. So, very much intense focus on those first four states, followed by the big Super Tuesday states. Some states have their primaries very, very late in the process. Actually, California is one of those. I just have the calendar here, and I'll just quickly take a look. California's primary is all the way in June 7th. Now, you can imagine it might be long over by then. Now, isn't that interesting that a state, which is the largest percentage of voters living in it, 35 or close to 40 million now, may have almost no impact, no say whatsoever in the voting on who the nominee of their party will be, because it will essentially have been decided by the voters in earlier states. It's a decision states have to make about where to position themselves in the process. It's expensive to run a primary, and sometimes it's expensive to move the date of a primary. There's a lot of tradition associated with Iowa and New Hampshire having the first shot, and candidates who have sometimes come out against that, saying, why should that be? Maybe other states should have the right to vote earlier have tended to not do very well in those very states. So it's like if you shoot at the king, you should not miss. In the end, this calendar has held very steady for quite a number of years. One of the other features of American political elections is how long they are. We're now closing in on the end of an entire year where most of the names we mentioned have been actively, publicly declared, running for president, raising funds, traveling the country, and we're still a year away from the actual voting. I think it's something a lot of Americans might like to take as a lesson learned from Israeli or British or other systems of elections, that the election has a more defined time frame to it. I think the last Israeli election was about 3 months, although there was about a three-month transition that followed that, so everybody's got their own unique features, but they're very long. But one of the reasons they're long, and then one of the reasons that sort of it becomes kind of a cycle, the reason they have to be long is because it's so expensive to run. To travel the entire United States over and over, to set up offices and have networks and volunteers in every state, to put on television advertising, of course, around the country, is a very, very expensive process. So candidates are spending more and more time raising money, and they need to start earlier and earlier in order to do that. And of course, one of the things that means is that there's a lot of influence in the hands of wealthy donors, people who can donate their own money, and even more so if they can raise money from others. And so there's been a very, very intense competition, particularly on the Republican side, where there's such a large field, to get the backing of very specific, well-known donors and fundraising networks. And so that's a big focus of the candidates. However, more recently, other candidates have found the sort of the secret to raising a lot of money in small dollar amounts from many, many people. I just read yesterday that Bernie Sanders has now broken the record that Barack Obama set in the previous election of the number of people who have contributed to his campaign in 1 year. It's over 2 million people. Over 2 million individuals have given some amount, maybe a dollar, $5, $10, not necessarily the maximum they can give, which is about $5,000 to the candidate, but they're going onto the website or they're showing up at events and they're handing over a few dollars or writing a small check. And especially through internet fundraising, it's become possible to raise, as President Obama did, hundreds of millions of dollars without necessarily having to rely exclusively on the wealthier and the large, those who can write the large checks. But something else happened about 5 years ago in 2010, There was a decision in the Supreme Court of the United States called Citizens United. And it ruled that providing campaign contributions is a form of political speech. And under our First Amendment, we have a freedom of speech. And so it ruled that many of the limitations on providing campaign contributions were unconstitutional, and they needed to, those restrictions needed to be lifted. It actually doesn't apply to the direct contribution to a campaign. There is still a limit set. It's $5,200 that you can give directly to a candidate's campaign. But it does apply, this lifting of restrictions, does apply to what are called political actions committees, or PACs. These are independent, or I'm going to put in quotes, independent, semi-independent political committees that usually are designed to support a particular candidate, but not necessarily, but they're not allowed to coordinate directly with that candidate. But they're set up by friends, by supporters. Maybe they have an issue focus, but a lot of times they have a particular candidate they support. And there's absolutely no limit to the amount of money that can be given to these political action committees. So some very wealthy people have poured literally millions, in some cases tens of millions of dollars, into these committees. And these committees will sponsor large amounts of television advertising and other forms of political activity over the course of many, many months. And it not only makes the election long and loud and hard to get away from because the advertising is so constantly present, but it also means that some candidates, it may make the primary process longer because some candidates might not do very well in Iowa and New Hampshire and South Carolina and Nevada. In the old days, if you didn't do very well in those states, your money was going to dry up. People would stop donating to your campaign and you would have to close, you withdraw from the race because you couldn't pay your bills anymore. Nowadays, there are some candidates who they can get by for many, many weeks without a lot of money coming in directly to the campaign because there is a network of supporters out there still willing to spend money on their behalf, not necessarily coordinated with the campaign, that's illegal, but it's still keeping them afloat. And so it may mean that the, particularly in a large field, like the Republican field, that it stays large longer than it used to be instead of narrowing down to one or two or three candidates in the early phases. The goal will be to get to the party conventions next summer with a nominee already chosen as the consensus, with the majority of the delegates chosen by these primary voters. The Republicans will hold their convention July 18th to 21st in Cleveland, Ohio. The Democrats will hold their convention a week later, July 25th to 28th in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Normally, it is the case that there is already a nominee who has already gained the majority of the delegates, and so these conventions have become not very suspenseful occasions. They've become essentially a gathering point, to almost a pep rally, to build excitement around a nominee and the person that nominee has chosen to run as their vice presidential running mate. That person is solely the choice of the candidate. It's not a separately elected nominating process. The candidate essentially chooses the vice presidential running mate, and together the convention will endorse them as their party nominee. But many decades ago, and it's not completely impossible to imagine, especially, as I said, when you have a large field that may take a long time to narrow, it's not impossible that you could get to the convention and no candidate would have the majority of the delegates selected. And then you could have what's called a contested party convention, in which there would be voting on the floor, and it might take one round or two rounds, and somebody would have to give their support to somebody else. There were examples of these in the 1920s and 30s and 40s that were very competitive, but it's been many decades since either party has had that kind of, maybe since the 60s, I guess, since either party has had that kind of, maybe the 70s. Anyway, it's been a few decades since we've had one of those types of conventions. Not so likely, but certainly possible. Now, once you have the two-party nominees from the end of July until November, anybody remember the date next year? 8th. Thank you. It's the first Tuesday after the first Monday in November, so you cannot have the election on November 1st, but you can't have it any later than November 8th. It's always between the 2nd and the 8th. You'll be down to the two main party candidates, although there's always the possibility, we'll talk about it in 1 second, of a third party or an independent candidate. And generally, they will spend the next 3 months, August, September, October, the beginning of November, traveling around the country. But they aren't going to go all over the country. Why are they not going to go all over the country? Let's go to the Electoral College map. Okay. So the way the actual election is conducted is not on a popular vote. It's not a national popular vote in which every vote counts the same, and you measure, and whoever has 50% plus one becomes the president. It's actually a state-by-state competition for electoral votes. And the electoral votes are essentially proportional to the population of these states, with each it's sort of the percentage of the population plus two. You get two extra electoral votes in each state or in the District of Columbia. It's the number of congressional seats you have, which are divided up proportionally by states, plus two representing the two senators that each state has in the United States Senate. This is a long held over feature of our political system, which is also reflected in the two houses of Congress, to try to balance the rights of the population by proportion where they live and the rights of individual states that have some independent status within our federal system. So we have in the House of Representatives a state with the largest population, like California, has 53 congressional districts. A state with a very small population, like Montana, so California is close to 40 million people. That comes out to about 600,000 people per congressional district, 53 congressional districts. A state like Montana has something like 600,000 people in it, maybe 1/80th of what California has. So they only have one seat in the House of Representatives, but both California and Montana have two senators in the United States Senate. And so the Electoral College, that was a compromise between the rights of states and the rights of proportional representation. And the same feature exists in the Electoral College. So the goal is to get to 270 electoral votes. There's a website called 538.com. It's the website of a brilliant statistician named Nate Silver, who has done incredible precise calculations of polling and different combinations that it would take to win the election. He does it in sports and other statistical models too. But the reason he chose that name of his site, 538, is because all those numbers on the screen add up to 538 electoral votes. That's the total number. And so the majority plus one is 270. So the winner is going to get 270 votes. But the reason the candidates won't go to every one of those states is because the vast majority of those states, everyone pretty much knows, based on demographics, which party is going to win. Most of these states, we can predict with near certainty who is going to win that state's electoral votes. California, it's been many, many decades since California voted for a Republican Republican in the presidential election. So almost certainly, those 55 votes are going to go into the Democratic column toward 270. That's a good head start. Texas is the other way. Texas, again, because of the makeup of the population in Texas, it's been a very long time since Texas has voted for a Democratic nominee for president, and so those 38 votes are likely to end up in the Republican column for the 270. And that is true for about, let's say, 35 out of the 50 states, give or take. It varies year to year. But there's only a smaller number, much smaller number of states that are considered battleground states, that are actually competitive, that have actually gone back and forth, some years Republican, some years Democrat. And so naturally, the candidates are going to spend most of their time in those battleground states. What are the battleground states? The well-known ones, Florida, always competitive, always has gone both ways. Ohio, Pennsylvania, Colorado out here. Iowa is pretty competitive. New Hampshire, several states in the Midwest, Wisconsin, Michigan, Minnesota, occasionally Indiana. Some states in the South, Virginia and North Carolina, are both becoming competitive. Missouri, another Midwestern state, always competitive, has definitely gone both ways. Nevada, as well is competitive. That's about it. There's New Hampshire. I think I mentioned New Hampshire. There are always surprises. Sometimes a state that people didn't expect to be competitive, the polling shows as the election gets closer that it's actually closer than people thought. And so candidates will steer time and resources into those states. But for the most part, they know the map, and they're going to spend time in the map. So again, we said California has a very late primary, June 7th. It might be that nobody will ever have to go to California to be competing in a primary because they'll know who's going to be the nominee long before. And when it comes to the general election, there's not much reason to go to California and spend time there because those voters, we have a pretty good guess of how those votes are going to go. You might go there to raise money. There are a lot of people who can raise money there, but you probably won't spend money on television advertising, the most expensive part of campaigning in California, because it's pretty easy to predict what is going to happen there. So you have that competition for 270. It usually comes down to those handful of battleground states. Again, it's generally between the two parties, and it's been a long time since we had any other than the two parties win any electoral votes. But that doesn't mean a third party candidate or an independent candidate can't have some influence in the outcome of the election. There's been a lot of discussion in the Republican side about Mr. Trump, and he signed a pledge, all the candidates signed a pledge that they would stay in the party even if they lost and support that party's nominees. But every now and then someone says, well, but if he ran separately, would he steal votes away from Republicans and make it harder for them to win some of the states they need to win to get to 270? That issue is on the table, and we've seen it. In 1992, when Bill Clinton was elected president, Bill Clinton defeated George Bush, the father, who was running for re-election. But there was a third candidate in that race. Anybody remember who that was? Ross Perot, another independent businessman. He didn't come out of an established political party. He was running as an independent. And he took about 19% of the popular vote. It wasn't enough to win him any electoral votes in any state, but there were some states where that 19% might have made the difference between the Clinton and the Bush, between Clinton winning and Bush winning, because he may have taken more votes from President Bush. The most famous example is in 2000, and this is when George W. Bush, the son, was elected, and he defeated Al Gore. In that election. And everybody may remember it came down to one state. It came down to Florida. In the end, President Bush won the election by about 5 electoral votes. He had 271. Gore had 266. And there was a third party candidate in that race. His name was Ralph Nader. Ralph Nader ran on a party ticket, but it was a minor party, and he ran sort of well to the left of Al Gore, the Democratic nominee. He probably took most of the votes from Gore. Maybe some people who weren't going to vote at all voted for him, but it probably took very, very few votes from Bush. At least that's the sort of pretty well accepted analysis. Now, in the end, after a long dispute about recounts and which ballots to count in Florida, it went to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court said this is the count. And in that count, George Bush defeated Al Gore by 439 votes in Florida out of about, 10 or 12 million votes cast. He won by about 439 votes. Does anybody know how many votes Ralph Nader won in the state of Florida that year? 95,000. 95,000. So you might think that if he had not run, if he had chosen not to run and maybe had thrown his support to Gore, a few of those votes would have gone to Gore, and maybe that difference between Gore and Bush would have flipped, and then Al Gore would have won that election. In that election, by the way, remember we said it's not a popular vote for the whole country. It's electoral vote state by state. Al Gore actually did win the popular vote. Al Gore got 50,996,000 votes. George W. Bush got about 500,000 less, 50,456,000. So if you just took it vote by vote across the country, Al Gore should have been president of the United States. But that's not our system. Our system is state by state. Bush won where he needed to win. Gore didn't win, so he had larger margins in bigger states like California, but then He didn't close the margins in enough states to get to 270. And that's happened, I guess, two or three other times in our history. All the others were in the 19th century, 1824, 1876, and 1888. So from 1888 until 2000, we never had an election where the person who won the popular vote didn't actually win the election. So it was a very difficult thing for a lot of Americans to realize that you can actually get the majority votes but not become president. But again, that's our system. It's in our Constitution. So there's not any debate about it. So let's see. Okay, so just to illustrate the Electoral College map from 2012, I should have done this earlier. For some reason, around 1996 or maybe 2000, all of the television networks decided that Democrats were blue and Republicans were red. I don't know why that is, but it has really stuck that there's blue and red. So blue states are states that President Obama won in his reelection in 2012. Red states are states that Governor Romney won. And so you see, if you're the Republican candidate, you're going to have to pick off some blue states into the red column in order to defeat the Democrat. If you probably count them up, I can't count them easily, but it's about even. There may even be a slight majority of red states on this map rather than blue states. But many of them are very small populations, and so very small numbers of electoral votes. Whereas Democrats have done well in states with larger numbers of electoral votes. But so the Republicans are going to study this map very, very carefully, both sides are, and look for the number of states they would need to add 64 electoral votes into that column. My guess is they'll focus on Florida. They will always focus on Ohio, which is a critical state that's gone both ways. Colorado is very competitive. Virginia, Minnesota. I haven't done the math in my head, but if they were to flip those states, it would get very, very close, and they might need one or two more. But it's the map. A lot of people say the map favors Democrats these days, again because of some population shifts and shift states that used to be pretty firmly in the red column are now what we say the purple column, where they're a little more competitive. But that obviously depends on who shows up to vote on election day. Now, just a few words about the rest of the election. At the same time, you have presidential election. We have our elections for Congress as well. 435 members of the House of Representatives spread proportionally across the country in a map like this. Each one of these districts has basically about the same number of voters. 600,000, give or take. So some states, the entire state, a small population state, is one congressional district. Others, California, it's a very crazy quilt. When you get down into large metropolitan areas like Los Angeles or New York or Chicago, you have maybe a dozen or two congressional districts all crammed together in a very small space because that's where people are congregated. So all 435 members of the House of Representatives are up for re-election every 2 years. So these elections will take place in every district every 2 years. In the Senate, there are 100 senators, but only a third of them are up every year. They're on six-year terms. So if you're in the Senate, you can breathe a little more easily. You don't have to run as often, raise as much money, and only a third of them are running for election every year. Now we look at the outcome. Again, red is Republican and blue is Democrat. And so you look at a map like this and it suggests, well, the Republicans really did very, very well. And in fact, of course, they are the majority in both houses of Congress right now. But not a majority that is quite represented by the visual picture that this map shows. Right now, the Republicans have 246 members of the House of Representatives, and the Democrats have 188. So their margin is about 60 members. But the reason it's not as dramatic as this map is because where the Democrats have done very well are in these population centers: Boston, New York, Philadelphia, Baltimore, big cities, Chicago, Detroit, Michigan, Minneapolis, and then out here to California, San Francisco, Los Angeles, Seattle. So where there are large cities, more often than not, the Democrats have done very well. It's also true in South Florida here, around Miami. In more rural areas, the Republicans have dominated. And so you can see they're dominating, but again, with much smaller populations in those areas. In the Senate, I don't think we have a Senate map at the moment. In the Senate, the current breakdown is 54 Republicans and we can say 46 Democrats. It's actually 44 with two independents, but both independents caucus with the Democrats. Both houses have flipped back and forth control. At the moment, Republicans control both houses. It is frequently the case that a successful presidential candidate will carry their party to victories in the congressional race. It's also often the case that in the next year, the presidential party tends to lose seats in the congressional elections, because people, after they've seen their leader for a couple of years, they've got some complaints and they take it out on the party in the election. I'll wrap up just one last word on what I think this election is going to be about. I think generally speaking, American elections, especially over recent election cycles, have really been about a domestic focus. They've been very much about the economy, about jobs, about people's feeling of the difficulty of keeping up with a competitive economy and a globally competitive economy. Maybe some growing inequalities in our economic system. And I think you hear echoes of that in both parties' debates. However, the role of the United States in the world, balancing the need to be one of the leaders of the world who keeps the world safe, who fights against terrorism and extremism, with a country that does not particularly want to go through another long-term military deployment overseas after a decade or more in Iraq and Afghanistan. In light of the events of ISIL and the attacks even in the United States, that issue is becoming more prominent in the debate. And then we always have our own kind of internal social issues, the ones that are not particularly economic. There's a lot of debate about guns because there have been a number of very prominent mass shootings in the United States. There's strong people who feel strongly that they want the right unimpeded to own any weapon, and there are people who feel there should be restrictions on that after all the attacks we've seen. The issue of abortion. A woman's right to make decisions about whether to carry a pregnancy to term is always comes and goes, but it's usually part of the election. And it may not be directly part of this election, but it might be, people might have it in the back of their minds when they think about who will this president nominate as a Supreme Court justice. The next president will probably be able to pick two or three Supreme Court justices, because several of the current members of the Supreme Court are fairly old, may retire. And so there could be some very important court cases coming along that might restrict or not restrict a woman's right to have an abortion. And so that issue is out there. The issue of gay marriage may have been more prominent in the previous election, probably less so now after the Supreme Court decision that made gay marriage the lay of the land. But we always have our social issues that also become part of it. So you got 11 months. To bone up, to get all your trivia straight, to follow the polls, to look at the battleground states, to figure out who's going to win what state. There are websites you can go to once there are two nominees, and you can come up with all kinds of combinations to see how somebody gets to 270 and who has the advantage here and there, and those are updated constantly based on polling and other information. So as I said at the beginning, there's a lot of fun in politics. There's a lot of even entertainment in politics, but it's all about something critically important, which is how we govern ourselves as citizens in free societies. So it's worth spending the time to study your own system. I'm sure all of you are experts in the Israeli system. Maybe because of the influence we have, it's worth spending a little time studying the American system as well. And so this has been a fun opportunity to discuss it with all of you. So let me end there for my opening remarks and be happy to take some questions. And what, water? Yes, I have some water. Okay, sure.
You talked earlier how every nation feels it has a stake in the United States elections. United States, after all, a leader of a very great coalition of nations in climate change, on fighting against terrorism, on fighting for democracy. And it's probably that the next president will have to fight a very long and probably very strong campaign to keep that coalition functioning and to convince the other members of this coalition, Latin American countries, European countries, to probably contribute more to the general effort. How is such an effort going to affect American voters?
Well, again, it's very hard to make predictions about it because I think there are competing impulses within American society, even within individual Americans. On the one hand, recognizing that we are a global leader, maybe some say the global leader, we certainly have a significant amount of leadership responsibilities, and I think most Americans embrace that. I think most Americans recognize that big problems that are international, cross-boundary, whether it's climate change, whether it's fighting terrorist organizations, whether it's opening up the global economic system to freer trade, requires an investment of American leadership. And whether that's diplomatic leadership or economic leadership or even military involvement, these types of problems don't usually solve themselves. They usually require a certain investment of American leadership. And again, I think that's something the vast majority of Americans embrace at some level. But there is tension with the fact that our own economy, while it's improved dramatically during President Obama's years in office, still has a ways to go to make many Americans feel that they are benefiting from the growth that we've experienced, and so they would like to see more focus and more investment of our resources at home. There is the kind of you might say weariness, you might say wariness. Of getting involved in foreign military deployments because we paid a very heavy price in dollars and in lives for the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. The decision about whether to go do another such deployment would be a very big decision and I think weighs heavily on people. And then there are those who feel sometimes that we're giving more than our share and others should give more. So this is sometimes a theme of the climate change negotiations where President Obama has talked about how we're going to bring down the emissions from American industry and how that is calculated against the emissions of, say, China or India or developing countries who maybe feel because they're not as developed they shouldn't have to reduce their emissions by as many. And so there are some of those tensions as well. But how it's going to play out is just almost impossible to predict. It will very much depend, I think, on events. If there are, God forbid, more terrorist attacks, it could affect people's minds, but maybe one way or the other. If there is an economic crisis, as there was during the election in 2008, when President Obama was elected, it could push views in one way or the other. Then again, there are positive events that can happen, or positive trends at least, which can reduce some of the tension or the fears that might motivate votes one way or the other. So I'm not going to offer a prediction but I do think these are competing impulses within American society, within individual voters, and I think within both parties. I don't think it's easy to peg either party as the party of being internationally minded or being domestically minded, or the party of being for international cooperation, or party of being for more isolating ourselves. I think we have trends of those in both parties. So it's going to be very much up to who the candidates are and what the events that they are responding to are. Yes?
I wanted to ask two questions. First, about the electoral system. Isn't that system a little bit anti-democratic, given the fact you said about the 2000 elections, that George Bush actually didn't win all the votes, counting all the citizens voted in the entire country? And two, also about the electoral system, isn't it also a little bit discriminating? I mean, your state only counts as 3 points, I don't know how to call it, your state 53, I mean. Aren't been complaints about it in the between American citizens?
Right. So these are, as you said, these are features of our political system that were established over 200 years ago when our Constitution was written, and when there was an attempt to create that balance between representing populations proportional to where they live and representing individual states who wanted to maintain a certain degree of independence. And so there are complaints about it. I mean, there are complaints even about the structure of our Congress. You know, there are complaints that say, why should a state of such a small population like Wyoming have two senators, and a state of such a huge population, California, also have two senators? You know, there are people who believe that's problematic, and the same way it plays out in electoral votes. But to change any of this, you would probably need to amend the Constitution. There have been some attempts to try to make proposals that would go around amending the Constitution, but they're very, very difficult. So the straight line way to do it is to amend the Constitution. That's also very, very difficult. To amend the Constitution, you need 2/3 of both houses of Congress to support the amendment, and then you need 3/4 of the states to also endorse the amendment. Well, you can imagine how difficult it would be to get people who have the advantage of a system like this to support a change like that. So the small states mostly probably don't want to have those changes because they gain a certain amount of power through this system. And there are more than enough of them to block a 2/3 in the houses and a 3/4 collection of the states. So it's very difficult. And so, yes, you can have these circumstances where the winner of the popular vote does not become election. It's happened, I guess, 4 times in our history. And that certainly raises a question about if the system is right. But again, it's based on a desire, which maybe still is valid, of some balance between population and states' roles. But let's look at the Israeli system. You have had elections in which the party that did not win the most seats was able to form the government. And the prime minister was of a party less with fewer seats than the party with the most seats. So we're not the only system. Almost any democratic system will have some feature where you can get results that might be at odds with a certain logic, but have their own logic. And so I don't think our election system is perfect. I don't think our democracy is perfect. But I think it's worked pretty well. I think it has held up. I think the institutions are durable. And even when we've had very controversial outcomes, people have accepted that is the outcome that the system we have produced. And if you want to change the system, you have to work very, very hard to overcome a lot of high hurdles that were set up to change it. In the meantime, it's the system we have. So, in the back.
Hi, I have 2 questions. Do you believe that over the years, that the citizens of the United States have become indifferent about the election? Do you believe that that's the cause that make them choose the same president? I mean, like, for over the years, it's been like 8 years.
Well, we have had 3 presidents in a row who have served 2 consecutive terms. Actually, that is fairly unusual. I think more often we've had one or two of those, and then a break, somebody who doesn't win 2 terms. I guess we've even had 4 out of 5 if you go back to Reagan. There's certainly an advantage. I mean, I think any incumbent has certain advantages of being able to present themselves as a leader, certain number of accomplishments behind them, and that is a certain advantage. But no election is certain until it is run, and you have to have a record to run on, and you have to demonstrate some ability to deliver on people's, what's important to them in order to earn a re-election. And I think a re-election is really earned in that sense. It is true that American voting percentages are much lower than many other parts of the world. There have been some years when barely 50% of Americans have voted in a presidential election. And in non-presidential elections, in the off years when it's just congressional, it's even lower than that some years, 35-40%, or closer, maybe in the 40s. That's quite low. I personally think it's a responsibility of citizens to take part in their democracy. Every citizen has the right not to vote, but I think it's healthy when people feel invested in the system and desire to vote. But in recent elections, the number has been going back up a little bit. I think in the election of 2008, when President Obama was elected, we were well over 60% of votes, which is a fairly significant increase. It may have dropped a little bit in 2012. A lot of the gaming, by the way, of how what the outcome of the election is going to be is who is going to show up. Who's going to show up? What President Obama was able to do in 2008 was motivate a lot of people who had not voted in previous elections, particularly African-American voters, but others as well, younger voters, students, to people who had just felt shut out of the process or maybe they had a certain amount of apathy toward it. They got excited by what he was trying to bring to the political process, and they came and voted. And so the overall vote numbers went way up, and his vote numbers went up even higher than, I guess, Senator McCain's did. In 2012, his vote total came down significantly. Not as many people came up the second time. So while he earned the re-election, he didn't earn the vote of everybody who voted for him the first time, but Romney also dropped a bit. So that election had a lower turnout overall. But turnout is a critical, critical factor in who's going to win. Yeah.
First, I want to thank you for speaking with us and want to wish you happy holidays.
Thank you.
I want to ask, we Israeli, when we cover the election in the United States, we usually seek for the Israeli issues. I want to ask how much the Israeli issues takes care in the American society, how the people in the United States care about things in Israel, the political issues and the two-state solutions and other stuff.
I'm glad you asked the question. It's something I probably should have mentioned. You know, there's no question any time you have a different president, you're going to have some change of policy, and especially that's true when there's a change of party. But there are some things that there's a lot of continuity about in our political system, and I actually think broadly speaking, our foreign policy has been one of more continuity than change from one administration to the next, even when parties have changed. Both parties, for example, were considered the United States and the Soviet Union to be in a Cold War and carried out actions to sort of compete with the Soviets in that setting for several decades. Both parties invested in building new relationships with Russia and with former Russian or former Soviet allies of the Eastern and Central Europe for the former Soviet Union in the years after, and tried to build that. Both parties have maintained the alliances with NATO, with our Asian allies, Japan and South Korea, Australia. And so there's a lot of things that don't change that much. There might be some emphasis, there might be a new initiative, but the broad contours of the policy, I think, have not changed. Now, I think that's definitely also true with respect to Israel. With respect to the rest of the Middle East, there's a lot of change in the Middle East, and that's causing everybody to rethink a lot of things. There have been some deep disagreements about Iraq and our military involvement there, and how long it lasted and whether it should have started and how to end it. And that definitely represented a big change from the Bush years to the Obama years, although it took President Obama many years to actually complete that military action. But I think when it comes to Israel, there's a great deal of continuity and a great deal of bipartisanship. And so I think as you can describe not just both parties and their political leaders, but the voters that stand behind them, the vast majority think of Israel as an ally, a fellow democracy, a partner in our common strategic interests, a country worthy of our support, and indeed Israel receives a great deal of support with strong backing from both parties in the Congress, and also a country who we have an obligation and a desire for our own interests, but also for Israel's well-being, to help achieve peace with its neighbors, including a two-state solution with the Palestinians. And so my guess will be that whoever wins the next election of whichever party, most of those features of the U.S.-Israel relationship are going to remain very much the same, and they're going to continue to have the strong support of the American people. So I think that's one where Israelis can feel a lot of reassurance, in a sense, about the breadth and the depth and the durability of our relationship and our alliance, and that those features of American policy are probably going to remain very consistent.
You talked about the funding Now, here in Israel, I think a lot of Israelis have a concern about the effect of wealthy people on the Israeli political system. And I wonder if American citizens share the same concern, and if there's any organization in the U.S. of the authority to check where the funding is coming from, and can funding come out of the states?
Right. So there is, I think, a lot of concern about the amount of money that is in politics and how much money it costs, how much time candidates are forced to spend chasing the money and spending time with people who have that money and raising it. There obviously was a decision by our Supreme Court that money is speech for the purposes of whether it can be restricted. And again, that's the law of the land. A lot of people disagreed with that decision, but when the Supreme Court rules, the Supreme Court rules. But I can't say it's without a concern. There is a Federal Election Commission that has the responsibility to monitor the fundraising that campaigns do. And campaigns are required to report every quarter, I think, to the commission their fundraising totals and where the money comes from. And there are those limits. About $5,200 is the maximum an individual can give to a candidate's campaign. Occasionally there are violations and there are some fines issued, but sometimes those occur months or even years after the election in which the violation occurred. So there's a kind of a slowness to the process. Mostly it's self-enforcing. Campaigns hire lawyers who track it very carefully and generally, I think, try to comply with those rules. But the new feature since Citizens United of unlimited contributions to political action committees is much harder to track. There, as far as I know, there is no authority that monitors or tracks or reports on those because there are no limits. Now, as far as I know, it isn't permissible to receive contributions from outside the United States or from non-U.S. citizens, even into those committees, although I would have to check that to be sure. So generally speaking, funds are raised from American citizens and American people who have that, or maybe permanent residents, people who have those rights of voting and participation. But it's much, much harder to track, and I don't even think the disclosure is very broad. I think the political action committees can basically decide whether or not to publish the names of who their donors are. So you could have tens of millions of dollars sitting in the hands of a committee, answerable to no one, without publicizing where the money came from. And it can put a lot of money into the system and advertising and potentially have a lot of influence. Yes? Sachini.
Thank you. You mentioned a few times the shift in the demographics. My question is about the Israeli relations, the Israeli-American relations in the long run, because I know already now from friends that study in the United States in different colleges and campuses, there's a lot of BDS and the apartheid weeks and things like that. And the question is, if the demographic shift that's becoming in the United States, if you think in the long run, it might the outcome will be different in their relations because of the minorities that have this different identity of Israel, like what you said the white Christians do with Israel right now.
Right. Well, I think there are demographic developments in both countries, by the way. Israel is evolving demographically in certain ways. The United States is evolving demographically in certain ways. And I'm not sure you can pin the events on particular campuses necessarily to that demographic evolution. It is true that there have been some campuses where there have been a lot of BDS activity. It's certainly counter to our policy and in free speech society. People can say what they wish, but it's not the policy of the government, and I think our policy is well articulated to be the opposite of that, to do more engagement with Israel, to help defend Israel's legitimacy internationally, to provide support in various ways, militarily and economically and others, to Israel. So, but the voices are there. I think it's too early to know if they reflect, you know, kind of significant demographic shifts. But I do think it is true that the demographic trends suggest that there are rising populations in both countries who may not know each other as well and who may not have the same historical and cultural connectivity that the you know, the people who have been at the core of the relationship for most of the last several decades have been. And so it may be true that over the next 15 or 20 years, you'll have the emergence of political party leaders in both countries who don't have the same experience, haven't spent as much time in each other's country. Maybe have, you know, in Israel, maybe aren't necessarily English speakers, maybe in the United States, people who have not ever come here or had a family or a professional or a religious motivation to come here. It may not be a question of lack of support or hostility, it may just be a question of lack of familiarity. And so it's one of the reasons in our embassy, frankly, we have put a lot of emphasis on trying to bring these populations together, the new demographic emerging populations in both countries together. So we certainly encourage visits by every demographic group in the United States, Latinos and African Americans, gays and lesbians, different populations, as well as those who have maybe been coming more often for longer to come here and meet Israelis. And we try to sponsor exchanges where we send all parts of Israeli society, including Haredim and national religious and Arab and Ethiopian and Russian Israelis to the United States and try to find new connections between all these different populations. It's certainly my goal as an ambassador that in 20 years, the relationship is even closer people to people than it is today. It's still very close, but that's not automatic that it will stay that close. It will take work and it will take effort and it will take programs and funding to help these populations who, again, just maybe because they don't know each other as well, stay close and stay connected and see the value of our having a kind of a common view of our future together. So that's something to watch over the decades, but not just watch. Try to be proactive about of helping to build the new connections. Right here.
I think that Israelis, it's not a substantial claim, but I think it's safe to say so, most Israelis feel as though Republicans are better for Israel. As an Israeli, you look at the Democratic Party now in charge, and you look at the deal with Iran, if you want to get specific, and you think, how come the strongest nation in the world can negotiate better terms of the deal? And I just wonder, what do you think about that claim? Is there any truth to it?
Well, I will not address the question in partisan terms between the two parties. What I will say is that I believe the President Obama's administration has been extraordinarily supportive of Israel in terms of the assistance we provide, all the military assistance for the regular program, but also Iron Dome and David Sling and the Arrow programs, which have been really life-saving systems. In terms of protecting Israel's from attacks against its legitimacy in the international community, in terms of standing up for Israel's right to defend itself whenever it's attacked, or even when it, before it's attacked, in the face of terror, in the face of rockets, in the face of any threat that it faces. We've worked very closely with Israel to help manage the instability around it in Syria and in Sinai and in other places that can affect it, and that Israel shouldn't have to deal with by itself, and so we've done that together. We've expanded our economic partnership and cooperation in many, many ways. And even on the issue of Iran, where we definitely had a disagreement about whether this was the right approach, we had no disagreement at all about the goal, which was to prevent Iran from acquiring nuclear weapons. We worked very closely together to develop the intelligence about the program, to build the sanctions regime, to build the coalition that supported the sanctions, all of the things that put pressure on Iran that brought them to the table. And then in the end, we had a different judgment about whether this was the right agreement or not. In the end, we feel strongly that this agreement will actually do exactly what it's designed to do, prevent Iran from acquiring a nuclear weapon, allow us to focus on the other things Iran does, which are threatening, and there are many, and do that together with Israel and other partners. We had the honest disagreement, which was well known, but you know, I think in many ways it's behind us. And when President Obama and Prime Minister Netanyahu met at the White House last month, it was very much a forward-looking meeting. They didn't rehash the whole disagreement that we'd had during the year. They focused on how are we going to counter other Iranian threats? How are we going to make sure this agreement is properly implemented and Iran complies with it? And we have the transparency to make sure they do. How are we going to be prepared in case they don't with a military option and others? How are we going to manage the chaos in Syria? How are we going to prepare for the next decade of our military assistance relationship, and we now have talks underway for that agreement. To me, that is a sign of the strength and the durability of the relationship, that even when we go through a period where we have a disagreement, a very honest one, very public one, maybe more public than I would have wanted, but that's because both sides were being very honest about it. The fundamentals of the relationship, both between the governments and the militaries and the security services and the people, is really as strong as it's ever been and continues to move forward. So I think that's the best way I can answer the question to talk about the policy. So.
Ambassador Shapiro, thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. I think that's a great place to end, looking forward and reassuring the relationship between the United States and Israel will continue to be strong and important to both countries.
It will.
Thank you so much for your support today for this program, one of our first programs in our election series, and also for all your support and all of your travels around the country for our public diplomacy and outreach programming and being such a great public face for the U.S. Embassy around Israel.
Thanks to our great PD team here at American Center in Jerusalem, but mostly thanks to you all for your interest. Keep following this election. Stay in touch with us. Lots more to come on over the next 11 months. So, thanks.
Thank you.
It's fun.
Safe trip back up the hill.
Thank you. All right.